conscience and faithful to dwell therein, let us pray to the Lord. For season of the weather, abundance of the fruits of theirs in peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For the trailers by sea, land, and air, for the sick, the suffering, and imprisoned, and for their salvation, let us pray to the Lord. And necessity, let us pray to the Lord. Help us, save us, have mercy on us, and keep us, O God, by thy grace. For all unto your remembrance, your most holy, most pure, most blessed, glorious Lady, head, focus, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commit ourselves and one another and all our life unto Christ our God.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse, and another чергу своему, изведи скоро на распутие, из окна града, и нищие, бедные, слепые, хромые, введи сему. И вчера, Господи, быть я уже повелеющим место есть, и вече, Господин, пробу, изведи на пути и холодни, и убеди внителя наполнится дом мой, благой по вам, яко не един мужей тех званых, кусит моей вечери, ноги по судьбани, мало же избраны.
Serafima, Emilia, Angelina, John, Alexander.
hearken and have mercy. Peace, holy, you pass with the dread of the seed of Christ, let us have.
having fasted for several weeks, we are now taking a very definite turn towards the feast of our Lord's Nativity. This is good for us. It helps us because we reflect on the fasting period, how we have done, what have we accomplished, and what we still hope to accomplish with God's help. Even if we've not even really begun yet, nonetheless, we have about 2 weeks that we still have to prepare ourselves, and with God's help, we can do that. One of the best ways to prepare ourselves is to listen to the hymnography of the church, to be at the divine services, which for 2,000 years have been filtered for spiritual and theological purity, and where we can learn the way many, in fact most of the saints, learned how to be followers of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today's gospel is a good example. Combined with the feast of the forefathers, that is the righteous who lived in the Old Testament, who were related to the Lord, we can learn some very important lessons. Something that we can put into use today, this week. Because when we come to the church, we enjoy the beauty of the services. We are educated. But at the same time, we can't forget that we are being given orders, as it were, to go out and act. Not just to keep our faith in our heads, not even just in our hearts, but that it will shine forth from us in the works that we do in the name of the Lord. In today's gospel, we hear about a lot of people who are excusing themselves from some party. This time of year, if we weren't in a pandemic, we would be looking for excuses to get out of Christmas parties that we didn't want to go to. That's okay. That's normal. But see, what they were asking to be excused from was not a Christmas party, but essentially from the kingdom of God. Because the Lord who made this feast was the Lord. And he was inviting his faithful children, the Hebrews, to come into the feast. But too many had been pulled away by the passions and vanities of the world and couldn't be bothered to come and join the Lord in the feast that he's freely giving them for their salvation. And so he sends his servants out, the prophets, and we may even say the apostles at some point, to find more. Where? Among us. The Gentiles. Those who did not know God. Who lived, yes, in the vanity of the world, lived according to their passions, but out of ignorance, not out of malice, not out of ignoring what the Lord had given them. And so they were compelled to come into the feast, that is, they were invited, they were given an invitation to salvation. And many were called, but few are chosen, as it says at the end. This reminds us that we choose. We choose if we want to participate in this great banquet, the banquet of faith, the heavenly kingdom, or if we don't. Today being the feast of the holy forefathers, we commemorate Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, all those righteous that I said were related to the Lord in the flesh. And when we remember Abraham, we probably think right away of someone who left his country and sought the promised land, which was promised to him by whom? By God. And we may think of this as some kind of old thing, some kind of ancient story. But you see, it has a very direct impact on us, those of us who are striving to follow Christ. We aren't called to leave a physical land, per se. Because wherever we go, we will bring with us our own spiritual struggles. But we're called to leave the land which values the passions and the vanities of this world above God. To leave that land where the, may say, carnal inheritance is, and seek a new land which is promised to us by the Lord. But we don't have a homeland on this earth. Israel is great. Nothing wrong with that. We should visit. The Lord gives us the strength, the opportunity, to do that, to be where the Lord walked, where he preached, where he taught, where he died, where he rose from the dead. But that's not our land. Our homeland is the heavenly kingdom. And as Abraham left his land in Mesopotamia to go to the promised land, we too have to leave our land that we are imprisoned in, imprisoned by passions, vices of this world, and strive for the heavenly homeland. And the only way we can get there is through humility, by throwing off these passions and these vanities and these vices of the world. And in other words, as St. Paul says, throw off the old man and put on the new. That is, embrace what the Lord has given us in our baptism and live like that matters to us. Many times we bemoan the state of our society, how God has been excused from the public square. Why is that? Because we, who are God's people, don't invite him. We can't expect the secular people to invite them, to invite him in. But we also don't. We don't make God part of our lives. At least I don't, not enough. Is Sunday morning? Well, that's good. But there's 13, 14 of the week still left. And we need to make God a part of that. We need to be like Abraham. We need to seek the promised land. For us, the heavenly kingdom. And if we do that, then God will be back in the public square. God will not be excluded from every secular conversation of our society. And our society will start to improve. Because the more God is excused from it, the worse it's going to be. And the more that God can be part of that, the better it will be. Obviously, there's a balance that has to be found there. But we're nowhere near the balance. We don't have to worry about that now. This is not a question of too much God in the public square. There is no God almost in the public square. And we can't blame secular people for that. We have to blame ourselves. Why? Because we don't make God part of our lives. God doesn't shine forth from us when we leave here. We don't take the liturgy with us. We shut it up in the church and it can't. God's grace can't have any effect if we don't have it within us. We can't share what we don't have. So brothers and sisters, let's strive to love God more. Let's strive to make God more part of our lives, not just on Sunday morning, but always. Let's strive to be more like Abraham, to love God so much that we trust him, that we will leave our homeland and seek the heavenly homeland first, just as he left his homeland and sought the promised land. This kind of love can change not just ourselves, but the people around us. Our whole society can be influenced by the love of God if we just have it in our hearts. St. Paul says, I have not heard, I have not seen, ear hath not heard, neither has understood the heart of man the good and great things which God has prepared for those that love him. Brothers and sisters, let us decide that we will seek access to those good things which God has prepared for those that love him. That we will put God first. That we will put away the passions and vanities of this life. Not just the ones that we don't care of. I mean all. And that God will be first. Not seventh, not the passions and vanities that we really care about. First. And that our neighbor will be second. And that only we, with our passions and vanities that we're trying at least to fight with, will come third. And if we do that, we will have that love of God within us. And it will shine forth from us. And it will change not just us. It will transform not just us, but also those around us. May the Lord grant this to all of us. Amen.
Your guidance be your own.
partake without condemnation of thy most pure mysteries, for the remission of my sins, and unto life everlasting. Amen. Of thy mystical supper, O Son of God, accept me today's communion. For I will not speak of thy mysteries to thy enemies, neither thy truths will I give thee a kiss, but like a thief will I confess thee. Remember me, O Lord, in thy kingdom. May the communion of thy holy mysteries be neither to my judgments, nor to my condemnation, O Lord, but to the healing of the soul and body. Amen. We have your voice for thee, it's great that we have your peace, the oration of Christos, the invokers of our church, the community of the 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 church, the
Blessing with the Lord has given you.
We will entice you with receipt from the church, and you can go and get your calendar. But you cannot go in the church if you don't get your calendar. Because it's an expensive meal, and if you're going to go all the way over there to get warm, then just grab your calendar. It's in this place in the church. So please take that. If you don't take it this week, we're going to send it to you. But it costs us like $2 for calendar to send them. And if you're already here, you can take the credit for it by taking your calendar. We're fasting, as I mentioned, through the end of the liturgy on Nativity, which is on the civil calendar, the 7th of January. Of course, in the church calendar, that's the 25th of December. The schedule has been published for the Nativity and all the services surrounding it, so you can find that on our website. It's also in this. It's not in Sunday reading, but it's in the Good News today that some of you guys are reading during the service. So you can find that there. You can also find it on our website. We have a couple of cycles of services this coming week. Tuesday evening and Wednesday morning for Father Daniel and the three youths. So it's 6 o'clock on Tuesday and 8 o'clock on Wednesday. Then Wednesday evening, we'll have our usual apophis for the hill at 6. Thursday evening, 7 o'clock, we'll have a new year related. And then Friday evening at 6 o'clock and Saturday morning at 8 o'clock, we'll have divine service for St. John of Kashka. So please join us for those as your schedule allows. All of those will be in the church, so we ask you to sign up for those so we know how many people will be with us, and so we make sure that we don't give away more spaces than we have. But that hasn't been a huge problem, and nonetheless, we still ask you to do that. Most of you, in fact, all of you, unless you came from this direction, I don't know how you do that. Had to pass by the construction of our new school. Thank God that we are able to do this and that the work is continuing. The trusses should come this week and be put up. We won't take a collection here today, but we'll ask everyone to try to set up a recurring donation to help with that. If all of the adult members of our parish give $10 a month, then we're going to crush this and it's not even going to be a problem. That's essentially the change from your couch cushions. So please have a look at that, and if you're in a position to do that, please set up a recurring donation also for the school. Cemetery spaces are available. As usual, you can talk to me or Constantine about that. Constantine is in the back, so don't ask. So you can talk to him about that if you'd like to learn more about the cemetery. Are there other announcements? We need to want me to actually say something about, you know, we've given over 1,000 pounds of food to those who are in need now. But when, because we're serving here on Sundays, and that's when most people come to church, we forget that we should continue to do that. So the box is still in the same place where it always is between the two bathrooms in the church. Please remember to bring a little non-perishable food item anytime you come to church, and we'll get to that 2,000 mark home mark very quickly. Other announcements? All right, so for those of you who are visiting, we're happy to have you. You're probably surprised to see so few people here, but approximately 97% of our parish is in Florida now on some kind of missionary activity. If you're going to ask me to bless you, I'm sure they're converting the heathen up right there, and so we're very happy that they are able to do that work. Oh, yeah. My wife wanted me to remind you, our friend, Puerto Rican Alexander Kishapok, who has come to us many times with us to receive him because he's the head deacon of the diocese and he's really good deacon, is in the hospital with COVID pneumonia. So please remember Father Alexander in your prayers. For those of you who don't know him, you are certainly thinking of a big, old, fat Puerto Rican who must be at least 80 years old. But Father Alexander, he can't even be 50 yet. So he's in high school, actually, seminary. So he's in his early 40s, and he's skinny. And so, hypothetically, he should be at low risk, but then he shouldn't have gotten pneumonia and be in the hospital. So please remember Father Alexander and all those who are struggling.
Thank you.